Welcome to the Football Show on PLZ Soccer's YouTube channel. I'm Peter Martin. Alan Ruff, Lee McCulloch and Tam McManus are with me here on the show. And we have lots to talk about. But I'm going to start by, first of all, mentioning a programme that we have called The Journos, which was on in midweek. It caused a fair bit of consternation. I have to say that The Journos is all about talking about various topics to do with football, not only in Scotland, but further afield. And everybody has their opinion. Whether you like it or not is open to debate. Now, the one thing I would say to each and every one of you who do support PLZ Soccer, we value your opinion and we value also your support for the channel. Some of the opinion you like, some of it you don't. Innocently enough, I put together a piece on Rangers captains, and while I'm a fan of James Tavernier, I highlighted the fact that he scored some really crucial goals. And for me, I thought his achievements should have been mentioned. Some of the panel don't agree with that, and they have every right to express their opinion. Sadly, as social media and society has a problem with sectarianism, bigotry and abuse, the point was lost after about maybe 10 minutes of it being on social media and promoted as a programme. And in the end, I think, from my own point of view, I turned into a Fenian Bee, which basically gives you an indication of the level of intellect that some people have on social media. So at the end of the day, if you want to be someone who watches your favourite club and all you want is positive stuff and you want the propaganda, please go to Club TV. This show is not for you. If you want to be abusive, if you want to be bigoted and sectarian, then again, there are platforms for you where you can go on a fans forum, or you can actually go and listen to some podcasts where people will gleefully batter people for their race, creed or colour. There are platforms for you, but PLZ Soccer is not that place. I didn't realise that when I was putting across a positive message about Rangers captains and me liking James Tavernier, I didn't realise that it was eventually going to just be lost because of someone else's opinion, and then the abuse that followed was distasteful and nasty. I don't mind, I'm big enough, I can take it. So from my point of view, I think for the broad public who do support PLZ Soccer, if on any feed you want to publish anything nasty or abusive towards anybody, including myself, what we'll do is we'll ban you. I would rather have 2% of decent people who love football watching the programme than 98% of knuckle-draggers and morons who gleefully will batter anybody because of their background. So I've said my piece on it. God knows what it would have been like if I didn't like the Rangers captain that I was promoting. But I thought it was an innocent enough piece. And for the other journalist who expressed another opinion on it, it was his opinion, not something that I agreed with. But that's the joy of a democracy. You're allowed to put your opinion across and then everybody's allowed to weigh in, providing, of course, it's not abusive. And how I managed to get it in the neck, I do not know. But at the end of the day, I'm sure it will be the case today with someone who doesn't agree with me. But if you do it on PLZ Soccer's platform, we'll ban you and we'll see the last of you here on the programme on a regular basis. I will do that just because I think there are more decent people in the world than there are cretins who abuse people. That said, this is what we've got on the show.
Philippe Clement claims Rangers' Europa League tie against Benfica will be the first time the Ibrox side have been underdogs since his arrival.
The first game when I'm here that we will be underdogs in a game.
Brendan Rodgers believes the title is still in Celtic's hands as he hits back with 8 wins and 2 draws stats. Neil Warnock insists that not everyone has to be Beckenbauer as he urges Aberdeen to shore up their leaky defence as they bid to climb the table.
Everybody thinks you've got to be silky and play ball. You know, put it in the touch. Not going to score from the stand.
Stephen Presley warns Hearts are becoming too reliant on top goal scorer Lauren Shankland as they cement their place as the third force.
Without him, I don't think Hearts are a goal scorer within the top 30 in Scotland at present, which is worrying.
Yep, lots of opinion there. Some you'll like, some you'll not. By the way, this is not a block on you absolutely caning me. You know, there's a free for all with a bit of decency. That was too long an opening for you, wasn't it?
I was towards the end when you said Cretan, I was going to giggle at one point, Jigmas as well. But you got your point across.
Yeah. Anyway, we've got lots to talk about on the programme. And of course, you know, there's Rangers, the draw in the Europa League, the Celtic's profits, which again are fairly positive. Joe Hart's going to retire at the end of the season. Scotland have got a bit of a problem with the coefficient. We'll be relying on Rangers to try and fly the flag and get as many points as possible. And we'll also talk about the interview that Kerry, our reporter, conducted with Stephen Presley. There's lots of great stuff coming up on PLZ Soccer that I'll tell you about. But first and foremost, Rangers draw Benfica in the Europa last 16. What do you make of it?
I think it's a good draw. Doesn't really matter who you're getting at this stage, it's going to be a difficult game. So Benfica, top of the league, we were just talking about them before the show, they're sitting top of the league. Obviously good standard of the league, but the way maybe Rangers have been playing recently, it's a good game for them. And between the pressures of domestic football.
Yeah, this is going to be a real test of them and the strength of that squad now going into this final run-in.
It is. They need to stay injury-free, ideally. Stay injury-free, suspension-free. The squad, they're still in, what is it, three competitions. They'll need everybody. And that's why I think the manager has been thinking ahead, rotating for the forward line or the forward five players, so to speak. I think he's been rotating them to create a freshness every game, and so far it's been working. I can see him continuing that right up to the end of the season.
You happy that the second leg's back at Ibrox?
Yes, I think that ideally, obviously the winners go away first. I think if they go there with a specific game plan, he's sitting deep, hitting the counter attack. If they can get through that game and weather the storm, then the way they're playing, they know they'd fancy any of the Ibrox.
You love that line, don't you? That's your favourite catchphrase, isn't it? Sit deep, hit them on the counter attack.
Well, that's what a lot of teams do in European football.
That's what your team
does. That's what we've done.
Sit and everyone behind the ball, quick header away as much
but
as you
if
can.
You play your strengths, don't you?
Oh, this is exactly.
Play your strengths, exactly.
Does he play like in the fives, maybe? They just sit deep and try and not let anybody in behind.
No, he just goes and savages anybody who gets in his way. It's as simple as that.
Especially you.
Him and Mulgrew are on a mission. As soon as I get the ball, they want to do me. Maybe it's just me. You know, because you're the housewife.
It's starting to sink in, Peter, isn't it?
It really is, honestly. I don't know what it is. They've loved you since day one, Ruffy, haven't they?
Well, obviously, I'm just a nice person.
You're just a big handsome guy. You're a big handsome guy.
Anybody says anything bad about me in there, I'm out of here.
When you look at it, I did mention to Lee there about the run-in and the games that you've got to try and keep the European campaign going as long as you possibly can. There's financial rewards. Lee's mentioned they're in competitions which could mean a treble at the end of the season, and suddenly you've got the Hibs in the quarter-final in between it all, so it's going to really test them.
Yeah, it's a really busy spell for Rangers, but that's what you want as a player. You want to be in every competition, you want to be challenging for trophies. The quadruple's still on. Rangers fans are still dreaming about that final in Dublin. So, and they've had a great record against Portuguese teams, Peter, in the last 3-4 seasons, going right back to Gerard. I think Benfica's only won, I think, under Gerard, but they played really well in both the games. But they've put Porto out, so listen, Braga. So I don't think they'll get into any fear, and I think the second leg back at Ibrox is massive, because Rangers, we are packed to Ibrox behind them. You know, if you can go and go over there and just stay in the game, maybe you win the game, draw the game, but just don't, you know, maybe lose 2 or 3. You know, if you can stay in the game, come back to Ibrox, I would fancy Rangers at home if they're still in it.
Yeah, Rangers boss Philippe Clement says it's one of the unusual situations where they were going into the game not as favourites.
It's a really exciting challenge because it's a very, very good team. I think it will be the first game when I'm here that we will be underdogs in a game. But you need to be also realistic. So you need to look at your budget, what you spend, what's the value of your squad, and compare that. So in that way, Benfica are quite in front of us. But I think there's a really special story developing here.
Yeah, the Europa League entire draw in the last 16, it just shows you where Rangers are in the company in the Europa League last 16. Sparta Prague, Liverpool, Marseille, Villarreal, AS Roma against Brighton, Benfica Rangers, Freiburg, West Ham United, Sporting Lisbon, Atalanta, AC Milan, Slavia Prague and Karabag against Bayer Leverkusen. In that company, could they go even further in your mind, Lee?
Tough group, innit? It's a tough school, as I say, I think.
Stevie Fingers teams.
It's just game at a time. Go over there, go to Benfica, try to get the best result possible and come back to a packed Ibrox, which will be difficult for any of the teams to go and play in and try and use the advantage of the atmosphere and the crowd. And I don't see why they can't put a run together with the form that they're in.
Yeah, Ruffy, the one thing that I think a lot of people will be looking at now is the fact that Rangers are flying the flag. We're under pressure as a nation. We're in 10th spot at the moment, but Czech Republic, they've got three teams still in European competition and they're closing in as quickly. So it won't affect this season's winners going into the Champions League, but it will come into play the next season. So, you know, you're really, in a strange sort of way, there will be fans out there looking and saying, can Rangers push all the way as far as possible in this tournament?
Yeah, and I'm sure the other teams that we're talking about, you're talking about Hearts, you're talking about Hibs, you're talking about Aberdeen, you're seeing the rewards that Hearts have got since they've been playing in Europe. So it'd be great if Rangers can go particularly further and get more coefficient points, because these teams rely on the money as well. And like the guys, I think, if they get a decent result over there in Benfica, any game at Ibrox that we've seen, teams know what they're going to get now. But it's going to be tough over there. It's a magnificent stadium. Fortunate enough, I played in that stadium for Scotland against Portugal.
Yeah.
And it's a wonderful atmosphere. So at this moment in time, Rangers defensively aren't giving anything away, and I think they'll be difficult to beat in Europe.
Did you win?
No, you beat one.
Yeah, absolutely. Your fault?
Yeah, no, it was the phone in front of me.
Okay.
We did beat them 4-1 at home.
Yeah, well, good enough. Good enough.
Portugal 4-1. Can you make that?
Eusebio playing?
No.
I have to tell you, Ruffy, your old teammate was asking for you in midweek. I was down there watching Liverpool Luton, and he sends his regards.
Yes, he played that night. Him and Joe Jordan were up front.
You think he'd have scored, wouldn't you?
Yeah, he scored two in that 4-1 game.
Aye, okay. What about the Celtic announcement of the profits, the interim profits for the second part of the year? Increased revenue to $85 million, trading profit $32 million, profit before taxation just over $30 million. Now, the second period is usually always a little dip here and there. But I think they've got over $65 million in the bank. It's one of those things that, as a business and a financially prudent board, lots of people will be going, well done, absolutely fantastic. And a lot of fans will be going, not so well done.
Yeah, I think there'll be more of the what's not so well done if things don't go well the rest of the season. I think the fans have already stated they're not happy with the way things are happening behind the scenes. And we all know that only surfaces if the team's not playing well. If they were to go on and win something, you know, that would take a lot of the pressure away. But certainly they really need to start buying some kind of quality that we all keep saying that they should be buying.
Yeah, and a strange situation that was on the release. Obviously, they just put it up on the website. There was no notification anywhere that the figures were going up. So I think they wanted to keep it quiet. they've made again.
Which is incredible. You're making a profit and you're keeping it quiet about it.
Well, it tells you everything about the board. The board know the score, and over and above that, listen, financially, you can't argue with it. Prudent, it's a business, and they are absolutely super efficient at it. The unusual thing in the release is that they had to highlight that January is such a difficult time to get the right signings in, and they tried to get some in, but they just were unable to get them over the line. Now, I've heard that line time and time again, to explain January away.
Particularly this season, Peter, when you see the carrot at the end for the league winners, you know, $60 million, you know, the new Champions League format, you know, you would think that they would maybe push the boat out and get one or two, you know, better quality players in. They haven't done that, and it looks as if it's going to be, you know, Rangers going to win the league now. And if they do that, Doesn't matter if Celtic have got 200 million in the bank. You know, it doesn't matter. Rangers have won the league and the fans will be absolutely raging about it. So I think the supporters will, they know Celtic's got money, they know the board, they've got money, they're well run. But as Ruffy said, they're looking for better quality, and now they've got a real proper challenge with Rangers. The time in January was in January, sorry, to go and sign better quality, maybe just bump your wage structure up a little bit.
Yeah, they're well used to rolling the dice, Ruffy, but this year more than anything, I think that board will be wondering how this is all going to play out, because it's not just a few hundred protesters, there's thousands of them now growing and growing and mentioning the fact that they're not happy the way it's going, and full credit to Rangers, who've suddenly just got the house in order, quickly turned it around. Now they've got their noses in front. It's a £60 million roll of the dice.
Oh, I would like to think that the board know what's coming. If it doesn't happen, you know, there's going to be massive criticism. We saw when the 10 in a row slipped, you know, that was a lot of pressure got put on people, and somebody's got to take the blame. But I think every time we see something, we say, I'm not going to bring anybody else in unless they're going to add to the quality. And even though they brought two players in, they're not regulars. You know, and fans are no daft. You know, if you keep telling fans, well, the next player we bring in, he's going to be a starter, he's going to be this, and then you're watching him and he's sitting on the bench, so it just doesn't make sound sensible.
Yeah. Scottish Premiership this weekend, lots of tasty fixtures. A cracker at Ibrox, Rangers against Hearts. Here's how it fits into the card. Hibs against Dundee, Kilmarnock, Aberdeen, Ross County, Livingston, St Mirren, St Johnstone, and Motherwell take on Celtic on the Sunday. The blow, Todd Cantwell out for 3 to 4 weeks with a hamstring knock.
Yep. He's been playing really well. I think he started the season a little bit slow, but he's come on to form maybe the last 3-4 games. He's been really good, so that'll be a big blow, but it opens the door for somebody else to come in.
Now, obviously I'm going to get everybody's predictions, but Rangers haven't lost to Hearts at Ibrox in 12 years. So this is a huge psychological bonus as well, if they can get the win, because suddenly, before Celtic play Motherwell, they could be 5 points clear.
Yep, it's just all about putting pressure on the team that plays on the Sunday. Obviously, we being Celtic, they can have put a little bit more pressure on them. So,
did you like to lead from the front?
I think it's better to go and play first, because you'd always be confident of winning the game, and it puts pressure on the other team. But if you slip up, it takes a wee bit of pressure off and gives them probably an extra incentive.
Yeah, okay. This one is going to be an interesting one, because of course Hearts are in great form. Let's see what the Rangers camp were talking about the opposition. Adam Binney was out there.
Rangers will host Hearts at Ibrox Stadium tomorrow as they look to maintain their position at the top of the Scottish Premiership. But they're up against an in-form Jambos side who have won 9 consecutive matches and have won 11 of their last 12 games. A big part of that is down to striker and captain Lauren Shankland. He's netted 25 goals this season, and he was linked with a move away from the Tynecastle club to Rangers in the January transfer window. So it's no surprise that manager Philippe Clement is well aware of his quality.
It's important, like I said, they scored more than 50% of their goals, so that's a lot of points if you see all season. But it's not only to be focused on him and to forget the rest, because then there will be other guys who will make the difference. So I played with my team last year against Messi, Neymar and Mbappé in the same game, but we were not focused on them.
However, Rangers will be without one of their key men. Here's a full injury update from manager Philippe Clement.
Todd will be out for a few weeks. So, yeah, of course, that's a disappointment for him, for the team, because he was in really good form. But it's part of football. And we coped with those things the last couple of months also. So it's about other players stepping up and showing the right things for the team. On the other side, Kemar trained a few times this week with a group, and with that we don't have so many offensive players, he will be in the selection also tomorrow.
Yeah, apart from a couple of injuries there, they'll feel confident they can extend their advantage. What chances Hearts and the way they're playing at the moment, do you sense from the Hearts side that there is a belief that they can go to Glasgow and win?
I think the players will believe they can win, particularly in the run that they're in. You know, the confidence will be really, really high. But going to Rangers, going to Ibrox against Rangers is a different kettle for all the games that they've played. They're going to Rangers, you know, a team in form, a team that's not losing goals, you know, pretty solid. It was different when they went to Parkhead and they beat Celtic at Parkhead. They weren't going through a good spell, but Rangers are in top form just now, so Hearts will have to go there collectively. Every one of them will have to turn in a shift, and he's already touched. Shankland has got to come up with something. You know, if he gives them a wee lead or anything like that, they've got a chance, but I think it's still a big ask for them to go to Ibrox and win.
Shankland, 18 goals, 26 games. Alison McConnell was out at the Hearts training camp.
Hearts manager Stephen Naismith has called upon his side to show their bravery ahead of tomorrow's game at Ibrox against Philip Clement's side. Naismith himself knows full well about what it takes to be nip and tuck at the top of the table in terms of a title race, and believes the Ibrox crowd could have a part to play in tomorrow's game.
It's about how we... when we have the ball, we need to make Rangers work. I've consistently said that. I think if you want to get results against the Old Firm, when you've got the ball, you need to be able to keep it, and you need to have the ball at times and not feel the pressure of the press or the environment. But like when you go to play the Old Firm, they've got a big crowd. It can be in a hostile environment, and that is something when you go to their games you need to touch on, and you need to make sure your players understand it.
Hearts go into the game on the back of a sequence of 8 successive victories. They're unbeaten in 11 out of their last 12 games, and Naismith is confident they'll take that belief into the game against the current league leaders.
In my playing days here, we very rarely went to Celtic Park or Ibrox and got a result, and you probably got into the games never having a feeling that you were going to. We've managed up until this point, we've managed to change that. Last season with 2-2 at Ibrox, we win at Celtic Park this year, we were close at Ibrox this season, so we are managing to deal with the occasion and the situation much better, so we just lean on all that. But that's the same each week, like I just touched on, the games are becoming normal, home and away, and it's about how you deal with them. So yeah, we're in a much better place going into this, we're in a good run of form, and like every game we go wanting to get the win.
Mentally they should be strong.
Yeah, they should be, but how many times have you seen a team going that's flying out with, you know, a Hibs or a Hearts and an Aberdeen going to the Old Firm, you know, with a chance to close the gap when they get thumped? You know, it happens a lot, Peter. And I'm not saying that's going to happen, but I think if Rangers turn up and play well on the day, there's only going to be one winner. I think Hearts are very reliant on Lawrence Shankland, as Philip Clement and Naismith's saying there. He's scored over 50% of their goals. That's an enormous number. So I think if you're a Rangers player, Rangers defender, you think you keep Shankland quiet. You know, I don't think Hearts have got that much in reserve to go and win the game. So if they can keep Shankland quiet, they'll win the game. And I think Rangers will win the game, and I think they'll put even more pressure on Celtic on Sunday.
Yeah, even former Hearts captain Stephen Presley agrees with you.
They are very reliant on Shankland, and we've got to understand just how important he is. But I would say that that's normal for sides to be, you know, so reliant on their goal scorers, but they are probably over reliant at this moment in time on Shankland. He's a pivotal player for them, hugely important, league's top scorer with 18 goals this season. But without him, I don't think Hearts have a goal scorer within the top 30 in Scotland at present, which is worrying.
Yeah, good point that he makes. If you want to hear more from Stephen Presley, then our reporter Kerry Pollock had a one-to-one with him, talking all things Hearts, Rangers, Celtic and Scotland. Well worthy of it on our YouTube channel. I like Big Elvis. I know he's fairly intense, but I had more than a few nights out when I lived in Edinburgh, and he's a good lad, much misunderstood.
I didn't like playing against him. Jig will probably tell you the same. He was horrible to play against because he's quite mouthy as well, and I played against him in a lot of derby games, and most of them Hearts won, and he would give you, you know, during the game, after the game. But yeah, then
what would he say? What do you mean give you? What would he say? You're rotten,
you're rubbish, yeah, you're a crap, you're a bottled it again, you're a, you know, all this stuff. And there was no really a comeback because he kept beating us. But then he became manager of Falkirk, and I played under him, and a totally different guy, totally different character. Thought he was a really, really good manager, good man manager, and enjoyed playing under him. So from a player to a manager, a coach, totally different person.
Do you play against him, Lee?
I think I did, aye, a couple of times. Good player and good coach.
Yeah, okay. brevity sometimes is the best way forward. short and sharp, that's what we want. Okay, give me your prediction, Lee.
1-0 Rangers.
2-0 Rangers.
3-1 Rangers.
3-1 Rangers.
Yeah, I think Rangers will win comfortably.
Okay, a comfortable 3-1. I'll go 2-1 to Rangers. Motherwell against Celtic. Any great surprise, Joe Hart going to hang up the old boots and the gloves?
I think it is the form he's in, Peter. He's probably in the best form he's been in maybe a year, 18 months. I don't think he's been in particularly great form. I've said in this show a couple of times that I thought Celtic could have done better and replaced him. But over the last 3 or 4 weeks, he's been excellent. He's been made some great saves, some important saves for Celtic. He's been tested a lot more than he's probably used to. He's still reasonably young. We were talking earlier, Ruffy's retired when he was 39. Craig Gordon's with 39-40. Alan McGregor, 39-40. Maybe he's just had enough, Peter. And Jig will tell you as well, when you've had enough, you know, you've not got the hunger to get in train every day and play all the time, then it's time to hang up the gloves in his case, so maybe he's just had enough, Peter, and he wants to go and do something else.
Yeah, look at his stats, Ruffy. You are better placed than most of us on his stats. England caps 85, 690 appearances, 10 major honours, and that list of clubs: Shrewsbury, Man City, Tranmere, Blackpool, Torino, West Ham, Burnley, Tottenham and Celtic.
Yeah, well, since I think 2010, he's been top of his game, you know, and that takes its toll eventually, you know. You set standards, you know, that you have to live up to, you know, and the older you get, I think it would be hard, you know, and everybody individually has to decide, you know, when to chuck it. You know, Tam was through injuries, I was 39, Lee's bank manager said, we can't keep taking the money in. But we all have different reasons, we all, don't we? Yeah, the standards, you know, the standard that you've been supplying for the last 10 years, and you know in training, and you know the new guys that are coming into the game and the way the game's been played, and you know that I really want to stop at the top. I want to be remembered as Joe Hart, you know, with all these stats behind, rather than getting up losing a couple of bad goals and people having a go at you. So he's done it, and good luck to him. I think he's had a tremendous career.
I always remember Paul Hartley saying that there was a point where he maybe people said he retired a wee bit too early, but did you fight? His justification for it, Lee, was that he felt as if some players that he wouldn't have really seen in his way were just getting that yard closer to him. Is there a moment in your career where you just realise that you're over, you're in the twilight, the edge or the speed or the quickness of thought is gone?
I think it does. It just comes with age, and I think your body tells you. I can't speak for Paul, but from my own experience, I think the body just tells you. It takes longer to recover, it's harder during games, the game gets quicker, probably year on year, so it makes it more difficult. So it's his decision. I think the goalkeeper, obviously, as Ruffy will say, it's a completely different position from playing outfield, so the body, no doubt, will be dictating to him.
I think as well, when you play with Rangers and Celtic, you have to set different standards for everybody else. You know, you can play with Hibs and Hearts and Aberdeen and whoever, and, you know, draw a couple of games, win a couple, but when you're at Celtic Rangers, the demands of winning every week eventually must, as you get older, be harder to maintain.
Yeah, absolutely. Joe Hart was well used to it down in England as well when he played some top clubs and, of course, at international level. So Celtic know they're in a title race. Rangers are out in front. But Brendan Rodgers, speaking about the title race and his team, it's still in our hands what we can achieve this season, so we have to focus on that. We've had 8 wins and 2 draws, and it feels like 8 losses and 2 draws. There will still be a lot of good in games. It's just when the result disappoints, and at times the performance disappoints. What do you make of his comments, Tam?
Unfortunately, the way Rangers are playing at the minute, 8 wins and 2 draws is not going to be enough to win the league. Celtic need to win every game, because Rangers are winning every game under Philip Clement. You know, bar the game against Celtic, they're in great form at the minute. And it's not just the, he's put the stats up there, which is fine, but some of the games, Peter, you know, the Hibs game, you know, they were very fortunate to win that game. Ross County won nothing at home, they were hanging on at the end. you know, dropping points against Kilmarnock. It's not just the drawing of the games, it's the overall Celtic performances. I don't think they've blew anybody away this season, particularly not in the last couple of months. So I don't think 8 wins and 2 draws in the next, you know, 10 games is going to be enough. I think he needs to win every game, Peter, and the Celtic supporters realise that Rangers are strong at the minute and they're winning every game, and unless Celtic match that coming into the Old Firm game, then Rangers are going to go and win the league.
It's amazing how things have turned, because we sat here 6 weeks ago when Celtic had 5 points and we were sitting here going, Rangers need to win every game at the end of the season.
They have?
Yeah.
No, that's completely turned over, as Tam's just said there.
Well, there's three of us now who think Rangers are going to win the league and Celtic will not catch them. You still...
At this moment, the way things are, you'd have to say Rangers, yeah. But, I mean, things have turned once, they could turn again. It's up to the individual players to get there.
Yeah, okay. As far as Motherwell are concerned, they are faced with the task of trying to get some better stats on their performances of late. Only one win in the last 5 matches. Kerry Pollock was out at Fir Park.
Motherwell host Celtic here at Fir Park on Sunday, but before we get to the weekend, Stuart Kettlewell has had to deal with some confusion that has been surrounding his contract, but the Well boss has ensured that he was never in the dark.
Contrary to what people might think, if I sign a contract, I know what I sign, so very simply from my side of things, I'm perfectly aware of it. Have been since I signed the contract, and listen, it doesn't matter what I kind of say here in terms of there has been a miscommunication, I believe, sitting at the AGM on Wednesday beside the chairman. They put his hands up to it, and possibly the wee bit that I go and take a little bit of hit for is the fact that, you know, I've not overthought about that communication following and staying up in the division and the work that was done last season from February till May.
With Brendan Rodgers' side having now slipped to second place in the league table, the expectation is that Motherwell can capitalise on the Parkhead side's dip in form. But Stuart Kettlewell says it's a lot harder than what people might think.
It's funny, I had to say this the other day, my 8-year-old son had asked me a question, is this a good time to play Celtic, just the innocence of youth. But what way do you look at it? You know, do you want to play a team that's in bad form, that have got real motivation to try and come out of a bad situation? I'm not saying Celtic's necessarily in bad form, it's just, or do you want to play that team that are flying high and they're winning lots of games and they could potentially take their eye off the ball?
Can Celtic stick on the heels of Rangers, or will Motherwell make it 2-6? Kick-off is this Sunday here at Fir Park at 12 o'clock.
I don't know why there was so much confusion with that. I don't think he was under any great pressure, was he?
No, not to my knowledge, no. I think it's a big game for him coming up. I think it's just miscommunication, which obviously can happen. It's a big game for him coming up. I think he's got a good point there. You don't know what Celtic's going to turn up. You should be able to tell in the first 10-15 minutes of what Celtic have turned up if they really want to go in and win the title. I think it's a difficult place to go, but should be an exciting game.
What's your take on, obviously they're talking and they put out that video, they were obviously looking for people to invest, Lee, from the United States and the Middle East have got, you know, people interested now. It might dilute the Well Society's, you know, percentage that they're there, but if you're a club in the top flight, do you need a major benefactor? Is that crucial to it? You know, especially to the likes of Motherwell, if they wanted to go and strengthen at times.
It's a difficult one, isn't it? I think they're just looking for investment. They're just looking for money. And by any way, the most important way to get it and the most money in, they'll take it. It's whatever model they want to work at board level, then that's the way they're looking to go.
Yeah. Kilmarnock against Aberdeen, this one. Of course, all the build-up has been about, and it's a great way to look at things, the Battle of Bramall Lane all those years ago, 22 years ago. Neil Warnock was the manager of Sheffield United. Of course, Derek McInnes was playing in the middle of the park for West Bromwich Albion. And there were 3 players sent off. A couple of players eventually were taken off injured. And the game was abandoned because Sheffield United didn't have enough players in the park. Now, it was like a wee bit of needle to go ahead of it. I'm sure Derek and Neil will laugh about that all those years on. But it's got the makings of a cracker. If it wasn't for the fact that you've got Rangers against Hearts, this would have a claim for game of the weekend.
Yeah, I think it would be a good game, Peter. I think that Kilmarnock are in a great run of form at the minute. Particularly at home, they're difficult to beat. Derek's got them well set up. I looked at their team last week, strong start in 11, and then they're bringing Greg Stewart on. You know, they're bringing Kevin Van Veen on. So he's got strength and depth on the bench. He's got competition for places across those front six places. What the boy Watson come on and scored the equaliser, he'll be pushing to start as well. So, no, I think Kilmarnock have got a really, really strong squad. Aberdeen, I'm still not sure about them. I still don't think they've turned the corner. And I'd fancy Kilmarnock strong in this game. I think that Aberdeen are struggling defensively as well. And Kilmarnock, one thing you need to do against Kilmarnock, even showed last week at Parkhead, they put loads of crosses in the box. You know, they make you defend, particularly on that pitch. And if Aberdeen are no bang at it defensively, then I think Kilmarnock could run out easy winners.
Patrick Mullen was in the Kilmarnock camp today.
I'm here at Rugby Park this afternoon speaking to Derek McInnes as his side are preparing to take on Aberdeen. It's an Aberdeen side they have already defeated twice so far in the league this season, but with a new manager of Neil Warnock in town, Derek McInnes has insisted he is bracing his players for a tricky game.
You know, I think like any new manager, you go in and you try to assess what you're seeing and also address things that need to be improved. So, you know, I think for us, it's like we've got an idea maybe what type of team they're going to pick tomorrow. But again, what I said earlier, it's just try to make sure we focus on us.
The most famous meeting between Derek McInnes and Neil Warnock has to be the Battle of Bramall Lane over 23 years ago now. But despite all of the bad blood on the day, Derek McInnes was full of praise for the longevity of Neil Warnock.
Real respect for his longevity. You know, he's 75 years of age. He's been doing it since 1980. It really is some feat that to be keeping going and still keep the fires lit for management, because management's tough, you know, and for all managers, young and old. And I think whether you're experienced or not, you know, I think there's a respect for the job that we all try and do to the best of our ability. And
will it be Derek McInnes' side that take all 3 points here tomorrow afternoon, or will Neil Warnock's side finally get their first league victory? Well, it kicks off at 3 p.m. here at Rugby Park, and PRZ Soccer will be there live, keeping you up to date.
Yeah, well, he's looking forward to it more than probably every other fan that's going to pay to get in. He's excited about it, is our Patrick, as he often is. I like the look of this one because, again, you've got Neil Warnock still trying to get a trick out of Aberdeen, and you've got a Kilmarnock side flying high with Derek McInnes.
Yep, they've not turned the corner yet, Aberdeen, and I think with Kilmarnock, the way their home form has been this season, the way their form's been probably the last 4 or 5 games, I think Kilmarnock will be slight favourites, but I'm going to go for a draw.
Draw, straight in.
I'm a wee bit of the lee as well. I think Aberdeen defensively need to stop getting cheap goals. You know, and like the manager has said that, he's sitting watching the game and everything's going particularly well, and all of a sudden something stupid happens. So I think midfield and up front, I don't think Aberdeen have got any problems just defensively. And if they can get their act right, I think they could get a draw as well.
Yeah, interesting take from Neil Warnock on this. He's obviously been well aware of the weaknesses that Aberdeen have at the back, and he's got obviously some wise words that he wants to offer some of his defenders for their lapses in concentration.
You've got to make sure that at the right time you make the right decision, really. And if in doubt, I've said it all my career to centre-halves, if in doubt, kick it out. You know, there's no... It's not up against you as a defender. Everybody thinks they've got to be Beckenbauer. Well, you won't remember Beckenbauer, you, but everybody thinks you've got to be silky and play ball. You know, put it in the touch. They're not going to score from the stand. It's not rocket science, really.
Now, a lot of people would lambast them in the modern-day football, but, you know, there are managers now who look at what they've got and totally understand there is a need not to play football in dangerous areas, especially when you're conceding goals.
Yeah, if you've not got players that can play, Peter, from the back, centre-half, that can dribble the ball out like Beckenbauer did, then, you know, defensively, you've just got to be solid. You've got to just clear your lines, be solid defensively. And if you've got players, listen, Man City can play out for the back, but they've got, you know, £100 million players back there that can play. So, yeah, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think he's right defensively. Aberdeen haven't done enough of that probably this season. You know, took chances at the back, haven't been solid enough, and it's conceded goals. So I think you'll find that a lot of the ball will be out of play maybe on Saturday, tomorrow. Yeah. If that's the way he... Because Derek McInnes is very defensive-minded in terms of defenders don't take chances, and so is Neil Warnock. So you might get about 32 minutes of play in that game.
Yeah, OK. I'm going to Kilmarnock to win 1-0. You?
No, I fancy Kilmarnock as well. I think Kilmarnock might win this handily, 3-1.
3-1, yep. Rafi?
Yeah, I would have said one each. We had a supporter at Partick Thistle asked to move his seat because the centre-half kept hitting him during the season. You know, when the centre-half's going back and they're facing the stand, there's only one place it's going to go. And it always seemed to go to him, so yeah. He asked to move his seat.
Hibs against Dundee. Hibs 7th and equal on points with Aberdeen, but they're 5 points behind Dundee. I'm going to go to this game. I'm really looking forward to it, to see if there's any improvement whatsoever in Hibs, and also to have a look at this Dundee side.
Yeah, it's a bit of a lone derby, isn't it? I think there's about 18 players or something alone in this game, going into it. So Hibs need to win the game, Peter. They're 5 points behind Dundee at the minute, in that seventh place. Dundee are directly above them. If they go and win that, it goes to 2 points. They've got every opportunity to go and finish in the top six this season. Dundee have been the surprise package all season. I think that the Tony Dawk and Stuart Taylor have done a great job, you know, mending all those lone players and you know, gelling them into a team. They've been really, really impressive at times. A lot of energy, a lot of legs in their team. Hibs scoring a lot of goals, conceding goals. But now, you know, I was looking at their team the other day. Hibs have got like 8 or 9 forwards now. I think they'd 4 on the bench, you know, and 3 of them come on. So they've got real competition for places. I see goals in this game, Peter. Might be a high-scoring game, this, but I think Hibs might just come out in top 3-2.
Yeah, just briefly, what do you make of the complaint that Hibs made to the SFA and the decisions that have gone against them?
I think they were right to complain, Peter. It's a stonewall penalty. We all agreed on that on Monday. And I think the SFA have, you know, gave them an apology, but that, you know, that's not good enough. You know, it's got to be... You've got to get those decisions. That's why VAR was brought in, Peter. Those are clear decisions. It came off his hand. It's an unnatural position. It should have been a penalty, and it could cost Hibs dearly at the end of the season.
What's your prediction?
3-2 to Hibs.
Lee?
2-1 Hibs.
Well, as we all know, we all read Tam's column every week, and I think if Hibs don't win this game at the weekend, the manager might be under a wee bit of pressure next week.
Yeah, OK.
Play Hearts on Wednesday night away, which is...
Yeah.
Well, make it to Wednesday.
Exactly. Okay, St Mirren against St Johnston. Managers obviously get a bit het up. Sometimes fans get to them, Lee. What did you make of Stephen Robinson?
I think it's part and parcel of the game, I suppose. A fan has got an opinion, he hears it. Manager doesn't like it, and he challenges it on the pitch when emotions are high. So I think anybody would have done the same. Apparently they've spoke to each other and sorted it out. So I think they just both want what's best for the club.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to apologise himself, the manager, Ruffy, because he just says, you know, you get passionate about these things. They've just decided, OK, you made your point, I'm making mine, and I'll keep continuing to do so.
Yeah, that just shows you that managers have the same passion that players have got as well, you know, and if... You set standards and you're winning and everybody's saying you're playing particularly well and getting results, and then you hear one individual with some criticism. St Mirren actually played okay on the day, they just never won the game, never took their chances and just caught them at the wrong moment.
Yeah, I can see this one being tight too. I've got 1-0, Lee, you?
Nothing.
He was going to go 9-inch.
Yeah.
I'll go 1-0. St Mirren.
Yeah, same here, Ruffy.
See a lot of goals.
2-0 St Mirren. I thought they had enough chances last week to win at Livingston.
Yeah, okay. And talking of Livingston, Ruffy, they're up there at Dingwall. It's the bottom two. Something's got to give. Lee mentioned it last week that there's a battle on, and he reckoned Livingston would be coming away from that bottom spot. This is the perfect pivotal moment, isn't it?
Well, they need to take something out of the game, you know, after getting that narrow win last week. You know, just as I said there, I thought St Mirren should have won that game, so they'll take the result, they'll move up there, they'll know if they win that game, what it means to them collectively. But I think Ross County the same, they'll have want to win the game as well. I think home advantage will be the big one here for me, and I'm going to stick with Ross County.
Yeah, okay. Adam Binney was out there to hear the words of David Martindale.
Livingston travel to Dingwall on Saturday to face Ross County in a match which could prove to be decisive in both teams' survival bids. Livingston are bottom of the Scottish Premiership, 3 points behind Saturday's opponents, who also have a game in hand ahead of them. But the momentum is all with David Martindale's side. They've won 2 matches in a row and the Staggies have lost 4 in a row. David Martindale has watched his side climb through the leagues with two successive promotions, has taken them to Hampden, and he has managed the team to a top six finish. But where would survival this season rank amongst his greatest career achievements?
Probably the most significant period in my managerial, in my coaching career. If we can keep Livingston in the Premier League, I think it's the biggest achievement I've had at the club, and that includes winning League One, getting promoted for the Championship, getting to a cup final. That's how relevant I find it.
Just a few weeks ago, Livingston were cut adrift at the bottom of the Scottish Premiership table. Everyone had already written them off, but it seems as though the tide is turning. But for manager David Martindale, simply getting away from the bottom of the Premiership is not enough. He wants to avoid the 11th place relegation playoff spot.
No, I want 10th. I want 10th, I want 9th, I want to try and get as high as we can. So, no, I wouldn't. If you say to me, bang on 11th right now, league ends, no, wouldn't be happy with that. I think we've still got to try and achieve 10th or better. And I know it's a big ask, it's a huge hill in front of us, but do you know what? I think we've got more than enough in the locker to overcome that.
Well, it's all set for a cracker this Saturday afternoon. But what do you think? Do you think the Staggies will run away, or will it be the Lions who are roaring towards survival?
That's the most positive lead that I've seen David Martindale in the last couple of weeks. Actually, really a sense of fight there.
Nah, he's coming off the back of a win. I think he's always sort of believed when even going through that rough spell, even if he deep down he didn't believe it, he was still portraying the message that he did. They've got the points last weekend, although they were one of the better team, and they've got a right chance to go up there and really, really bring Ross County into it. So I fancy them.
I think he's telling Porky's there. I think he would take 11th now, Peter.
Yeah.
I think so. I think they've won three games all season, you know, and you know they're 8 points behind St Johnson. I don't think they're going to catch them. I think he would take 11th right now, but I think Ross County will beat them, and I think that little bit of positivity that David's portraying there will be on the back burner again on Monday, because I think Ross County will go 6 points clear of them again.
Yeah, I've got 1-0 Ross
2-1, County. 2-1 to Ross County.
Ruffy?
I've got 2-1 Ross County.
What did you say there, Lee?
1-0 Livingston.
Livingston. Carabao Cup? What do you think? Liverpool, Chelsea?
Liverpool.
Liverpool.
Yeah.
Liverpool.
Yeah, okay, that was short and sweet, you guys. Okay, listen, thank you to Lee and to Ruffy and to, of course, Tam McManus here on the show. Don't forget, there's lots of great interviews. Charlie Adam, there's a special, we've got a documentary there, which I'm sure you'll enjoy. Kerry's been speaking to Stephen Presley as well. So there's lots to look forward to across all our programmes. Of course, Tam and Ruffy head-to-head, as ever, with Kerry in the Premiership preview on the Saturday morning. I'll finish again with the basis that I thank so many fans right across the whole of our support, from Rangers, Celtic, Aberdeen, Hearts, Hibs. There's lots of great fans out there who follow the channel and follow it in a positive way, and we've had lots of really good positive messages. Right across the board, it's some people from lots of clubs across the board who just don't know how to behave themselves, and we like to mention that we obviously want to try and promote football in a positive sense and try and be as balanced as we possibly can, try and get it right as often as we possibly can. We're open to criticism, but certainly not abuse, and that goes for every Premiership club and some fans who just let everyone down. But the main people who follow this channel right across the board, Old Firm fans, Edinburgh Derby, the lot, are all positive and deserve our respect, and we thank them for their support. So from everybody here in the Football Show, I hope you've enjoyed the programme. You might agree with some of it, you might disagree, but you will get an opinion. Thank you for supporting PLZ Soccer. And from Lee, Ruffy, Tam and myself, Peter Martin, thank you for listening and watching.